Today's episode of The Real Deal with Damian Adams is brought to you by The 3-Point Conversion. Now, 3-Point Conversion is where fans' opinions matter. If you are a sports fan and you're not following The 3-Point Conversion on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, you are living life incorrectly, all right? So make sure you follow The 3-Point Conversion on all those platforms. You get access to great articles on the NBA, NFL, boxing, soccer, college football, college basketball. You get in-depth interviews with all types of athletes, Marshall Faulk, Skylar Diggins-Smith, Don Taurasi, Evander Holyfield. The list goes on and on and on. The 3-Point Conversion is where it's at. The 3-Point Conversion is where fans' opinions matter. Thank you for listening to The Real Deal with Damian Adams. This is real sports talk for the real sports fan. And I definitely appreciate all you real sports fans who are listening right now. If you're listening on Apple Podcasts, thank you, thank you, thank you. Please do not forget to help a brother out and give me that 5-star rating, that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That 5-star rating will definitely be appreciated. If you're listening on the 3-Point Conversion Station on Spreaker Radio, thank you, thank you, thank you. The 3-Point Conversion Station is where fans' opinions matter. So if you think the show is hot, say it loud. I think the show is hot and I'm proud. If you think the show can improve, don't say it as loudly, but please let me know, because I need both your praises and your criticisms to be great at my job. Now, I'm very excited about today's show. Today, I wanted to give you guys some recommendations on NFL games that you should go back and watch and count down some of the most rewatchable NFL games of all time. And to do that, I wanted to bring on a guest who I know when it comes to the NFL, NBA, Major League Baseball, all sports, this guy knows his stuff. He is one of the hosts of the 3-Point Conversion Sports Lounge, which you can catch every Saturday on the 3-Point Conversion Facebook page. Also, you can catch it live on the radio in Atlanta, which you can get that station wherever. He also is the CEO of the 3-Point Conversion, which has the best team of writers for any sports media outlet. Not small, not big, not medium. Any media sports outlet out there, the 3-Point Conversion has the most talented team of writers of any of them. Yeah, I said it. And this man is the one who put that team together, the hardest working man in sports media, representing Chicago, now living in Atlanta, Raphael, but in the hood they call him Mr. Controversy. What's going on, Mr. Controversy?
What's going on, man? Did you miss me? Hey, bro, you, I'm not gonna lie, that was the best introduction I ever had.
Yeah, I've been trying to work on my intro game, man. That's something I've been trying to perfect.
Yeah, so you're working on it, Dan. It's good, I'll say that.
Yeah, I appreciate that. So, it's been a while since you've been on the show. And whenever I have people on for the first time or it's been a while, I want them to, you know, let the people know who they are so they can, the audience can appreciate the guests like I appreciate them. So I already let them know that you are the host of 3-Point Conversion Sports Lounge from Chicago. And living in Atlanta, man, what have you been doing during this period of self-quarantine? How have you been keeping yourself busy?
Praying for sports to come back. Man, it's been tough, man. You know what, though? Outside of sports, I kept saying that it could go either way, you know, being with your family, being, if you're married or you're in a relationship, being in there with your, you know, significant other, it could be either great or it could be challenging because you're not used to spending that time with each other. So it could be great because you can spend more time, especially if you're a sports guy, sports person. They don't, you know, now you can just spend that time. They want that quality time. You can spend it more. But it is good. But at the same time, if they're not used to you and y'all not used to being around each other or just being around each other for that wrong for this long period of time, it could be the wrong, go the wrong way. Luckily, it's been great for me, so we've gotten closer, so me and my wife gotten closer, but cool, man. You know, I've been watching a couple of shows, watch some movies I hadn't checked out or whatever, so you know it got bad when I watched. And it's not a bad movie, but I watched Longest Yard, the original one with Burt Reynolds, one day. So I was like, man. But it's been cool, man. Like, I've been watching, I watched a show, I don't know if you've seen it, called All American.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's good. And I'm not usually a binge watcher. I don't, you know, I don't usually do that. I don't, like you stated earlier, I don't really have that time to do that. So now that I have time, and it's kind of been like a blessing in disguise as far as this time, having this time. I hate that what we're going through, but because of doing so much and always editing, you know, the show, writing, or at a game, whatever it is, you know, it's a lot. But now I have downtime, so it's been like a vacation in a sense for the last, you know, few weeks. So I'm taking advantage of it. But I'm not a binge watcher, so I watch All American, and me and my wife spending time watching the show, man, weeks. One day we watched about like 10 shows one day. So I'm kind of messed up because I done finished it. And, you know, I'm like, man, ain't nothing else to watch. You know, so, but that's been a good show, though. I've been checking that out. So doing stuff like that, man, especially Netflix. Watching, shout out to Darrell Owens, man, the tournament. I've been watching that on Facebook Live, his live tournaments. So that's been good. And the Up and Smoke podcast, man, you know what I'm saying? That's been great. I've been checking that out. So, you know, so stuff like that, man.
Yeah, no, that's a really good podcast. I do check that one out as well. Also like the one with Crit Richardson and Darius Miles as well, the Knuckleheads. They do a good job as well. For All American,
I haven't watched that yet.
They do good interviews. They do good interviews. Their first question is always dope because they always ask the player who was the first person to bust them up in the league. And some of the answers you get are hilarious. Like with Kyrie Irving, it was like, oh, who was the first person to bust you up in the league? And he was like, Jose Calderon. He was like, Jose Calderon. He was like, man, Jose Calderon gave me the business my rookie year. And like some of those answers you get, you know, because, you know, sometimes they'll go in, rookies, and they say, oh, you know, we thinking this guy, we saw him playing, he just all right. But you get to the league, like, oh, everybody's good in the league. So you mess around and take somebody too lightly, right, you get bust up. So some of those answers are hilarious. So I like their podcast as well. For All American, it is a really good show. For people out there who are not familiar with it, it's following this high school football player who's very good, and he's in Crenshaw, and y'all, he gets a chance to go out to Beverly Hills to play. And in that transition, he comes across a lot of drama between him trying to transition to getting used to being in Beverly Hills, you know, not leaving behind his friends in Crenshaw and his family in Crenshaw, dealing with, there's Coach Crenshaw being the hood, there's, you know, that type of drama as well. Then you have the drama of just on the football field of him trying to get a scholarship. And it is a lot of different stories in there. And it's a really good show. I like it a lot. And plus, it's high school. So you're always going to have that high school drama as well. And we all remember it. You know, no matter how far removed you get from high school, you remember what it was like. And All American definitely brings you back there. So I like that show as well. You said that you and your wife have watched some movies. What's some movies that you guys have seen?
We just watched Angel Has Fallen. I think that's after Olympus Has Fallen. I mean, you can't tell because Morgan Freeman's in it, and, you know, you can't tell by the age, you know. So, I don't know which one. But I think this is newer. I don't know, but like I said, you can't tell with him. But it's good. It's funny because him and the guy, what's the guy named? Russell, it's not Russell Crowe.
No.
Who was the guy that played in Gladiator? No, not that, Gladiator, but
300?
What was it called? Like 300, yeah.
Oh, man. I know who you're talking about. I can't remember his name right now, but yeah.
So he was in Olympus Has Fallen, and he's in this also with Morgan Freeman. Both of them still, they're the president, you know what I mean? And Morgan Freeman's the president of both, and it's not the same character, which is cool, but I don't think it is. Yeah, I don't think it is. But yes, Theo, it was it's a good movie, man. It's a real good movie. We believe it or not, I watched Chalet for the first time, and you would say, okay, you're from Chicago. Well, the thing is, we don't like calling it Chalet.
Yeah.
Up there, so you know, we thought I was we didn't like that, so I didn't really mess with it. But I heard it was good, and I watched it. It was pretty cool, man. Sandy Weckman, I think that's it, with Adam Sandler.
Yeah.
That's a great movie. I just saw that for the first time. I'm not really a movie person, so I don't really have time. But so catching up on movies, man, and it's been cool, man. Like I said, it's cool with the family and everything. And if I can say, the funny thing about All American, I look at it, it's great. I think it's probably the best show out there. I mean, I haven't seen Ozark. My wife's been watching this show called My Block or something like that, On My Block.
Yeah.
With high schools, yeah, that was pretty interesting. I caught it in the middle, so trying to follow. But with All American, it's like the newer version of Good Times. The only reason I say that because, like, always something bad happening. Like, but at least good stuff happened in it. But it's like, dang, can something good just happen and that's it? But, man, for them to be high school people, man, they definitely, they be doing some stuff they should be doing to be in high school, right?
Yeah, yeah, they definitely advanced. But that's with age, that's what it comes with times, too. Like, you know, my little sister's right. 10 years younger than me, and some of the stuff that she went through in high school, I was like, really? You're going through that stuff in middle school, high school? So it just happens when it comes with the times as well, with kids just going through more and more. But you mentioned Good Times, and we recently laughed about you got a chance to meet Thelma from Good Times. Like, how was that exchange?
Oh, Jesus. So the funny thing is, when I met her, I hope my wife don't listen to this, but when I met her, we were at some, they have these like outside concerts, whatever, I think it was, I forgot what it was, but it was like this concert, old throwback concert, you know, 90s music, whatever, we was outside, and she had a little booth, so me and my wife saw her, like, oh, that's, I'm like, that's Thelma. You know, she like, yeah, nice, whatever. So we went and sat down, and well, I had to go use the bathroom, kind of, you know, I had to play it off, and I came back and went to her booth and saw her. She was like, hey, and I told her. I was like, man, I had to tell her. I know everybody used to tell her that, but I told her, and they ain't me. But I had to tell her, I was like, look, I ain't gonna lie, boy. I got a crush on you. She's like, oh, that's nice. I was like, yeah, still got a crush on you. Like, yeah, but always. And she started laughing, like, oh, that's so sweet. Gave her a hug and everything. And they had to get some people to, you know, like, you know, take me off of it because I wouldn't let go. So I had my eyes closed. Bruh, meet her? Man, that was a dream come true right there. Her and Doris Burke, those are the ones that Felicia Rashad, three people that I always fell in love with when I was young, you know what I'm saying? Or not even young with Doris Burke. I just got a big crush on her. I got to meet her. But meeting Thelma, that was, bruh, I think every man will feel that way. If you watched Good Times before, Thelma was, man. So just to meet her, she still was looking nice. You know what I'm saying? So that was crazy, bro. That was big time, you know. So, yep.
Yeah, now I just remember.
Thanks for bringing that up, man.
Now I just remember watching Good Times. I watched the reruns. Like, I wasn't present for when it was running. And watching the reruns on TV Land, I remember my dad would always talk about how, you know, Thelma was the one for him. And every time we watched the reruns, and I saw like, you know how they do the Where Are They Now shows, and I remember seeing one of those shows, and I was watching it with my friends. I was a teenager at this time, and Thelma was still looking good. And I remember telling one of my friends, like, Thelma still, she's still one right there. And they didn't watch, they didn't watch any of the old shows, so they wasn't like really familiar. And they looking at me like I was tripping. I'm like, y'all tripping right now.
Right. And you know what? The funny thing is, this was like a couple years ago. So, granted, you know, this was after the All-Star. So I went and I had talked to LeBron James. I met Magic. I saw all these big stars, man, you know, that you can meet, man, and in today's game and everything, even past people in the past, but like to play, you know, in NBA or NFL in the past. But when I saw Thelma, you talk about, I was like, my heart was beating fast. I was nervous. And, bruh, it was crazy, man. I never will forget that.
I'm glad you got to have that experience. I didn't get to meet, you know, my crushes like that. So I'm glad you got to have that experience. So now let's transition over to sports. You are a big Chicago Bears fan. You guys have been busy this offseason. What are your overall feelings towards what the Bears have done this offseason?
I think the biggest move. Well, before I get to the biggest move, I'll talk about, I was shocked when they cut Prince Amukamara. I can never say his name right, but I was shocked when they cut him because he was durable. He might, like, it's like every game he would get hurt and he would be out for two plays, but he'd come back in. But he was durable, tough. You know, I was shocked that they cut him. But other than that, man, I thought getting Robert Quinn, I thought that was a big move. That was a great move, you know, we cut Leonard Floyd, which, I mean, that was my guy, but we should have. But to get Robert Quinn, this guy still got the speed. He's still young. I think he's only like 29 or something like that. It's not like he played in the NFL forever. But he had 11 sacks last year, and he didn't play every step. You know, he wasn't every down linebacker or rush. He became a passing now. So to get him with Khalil Mack now, you can still focus on Mack, but you had to worry about Quinn now. So that's going to open him up, you know. So that was big. I was sick when we lost, we call him baby Keithley. My guy, his name slipped out of my head, the linebacker for the Bears. I can't think of his name now, it slipped out of my head, but number 44, I was sick when we let him go. I got to look it up real quick. But I was sick when we let him go just for the simple fact that he was that linebacker that was coming up. Like, I know we got Roquan, you know, Roquan and everything, but still, I didn't want to lose him. And the biggest, of course, I thought was getting Nick Foles. Not just because we think he's going to start, but just the fact that he's going to be there to push Mitch, you know, with what Mitch has gone through. And my thing is, everybody jokes about Mitch. I think last year was kind of one of those unfair years for Mitch, just because the fact that, yeah, he played horrible the first few games. I'm not, you know, I understand that. But then he get hurt. When he have a good, the third game he gets hurt, I mean, third game he has a great game against Washington, right, after two bad games, like he's getting his rhythm. The next game he gets hurt, the third play of the game. Then after that, we mess around and bring him back. Now he's playing with his harness. So he's uncomfortable with the harness, we know that. Still play bad, though, but with that harness, he can't play his normal game running around, can't do that. So he looks bad, he doesn't look the same. Kind of seen a glimpse every now and then. But then the last five games, if you look at his numbers, Mitch starts to ball off. He started to play well. start getting used to the harness. They start letting him run the ball. Now he's running from the quarterback position and playing this game. He's playing better now. So to me, I thought he was judged unfairly, and I thought the media, which they always do, and I blame Jay Cutler. And once you have Jay Cutler, and they don't like Jay Cutler anymore, how Jay Cutler played when he was in Chicago. Now every quarterback after Jay Cutler is going to have to suffer that. If you're not good, and then the fact that because Watson and Mahomes are playing great, like, that's not Mitch's fault. You can get mad at the GM, but you can't blame Mitch. You know what I'm saying? Like, the year before last, he had a very good season. So, but to pick Nick Foles, pick up Nick Foles to push him, that's what they're really going to do, is push Mitch. And if Mitch doesn't play well, then you have Nick Foles come in. Now, my thing is, I want Mitch to start, and I'd rather let Mitch start the first 11 games, and no disrespect. I don't want anybody to get hurt or anything, but either they could designate somebody to, like, hit Mitch real hard or something, and then let Nick Foles come in the last that 12th game and take it to the Super Bowl. That's perfect.
Yeah, that is when Nick Foles is at his best, when he gets to come in late in the year. The two runs he had with Philly, he came in later in the year, got him to the Super Bowl, and the last one, he got him to the NFC Division round. They lost to the Saints. So as you can definitely say that would be the best way to go. So you still are a believer in Mitch, and you think that Nick Foles will be there as the backup?
The thing is, they want Mitch, and it's not like they don't like Mitch. They believe in Mitch. And GM said it himself that it's still Mitch's team. Now, they came out recently and talked about how they want to, it's going to be open. But for the most part, they like Mitch, and I guess they feel the same way that I felt like it was unfair for, Mitch, for what he went through. Let's give him another season. Because, again, man, this rookie season, he didn't play well. Well, I take that back. Nothing, he didn't play well. The team was horrible. He came in, he did all right. You saw, okay, he could be the future. We had no receivers, none, no receivers. And then all of a sudden, the next year, second year, he has a 97 quarterback rating for a second year. And like I said, he does well. He did well. He was an alternate for the Pro Bowl. You're not going to be an alternate for the Pro Bowl if you're not good. You know what I'm saying? So I think that after that, and then this year he didn't do well. It's kind of like, okay, what do we really have? So for you to draft him that early, you really want to know what type of quarterback you have. You understand? Like, what do I have on my quarterback? So you have to give him another chance to start. You have to. I believe you give him a chance. But if he doesn't play well preseason, which he's probably not going to play at all, then, okay, you go ahead and let Nick come in. But for the most part, it's only three preseason games. I'm only going to play one game, if that. Just let him start, man. And if he starts, I don't want them to yank him just because he threw one pick or listen to the media. Let him play. Let him play four games. Let's see what he does. You know what I'm saying? If he doesn't play well after four games, then you yank him. I agree with that. But other than that, I say you got to give him a chance just to see what you have at least. Okay. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, and I definitely can see that point of view. You mentioned some good points about him being hurt last year and the year before last, how he played well and led you guys to the playoffs. So I can definitely see why you want to give him a chance. And hopefully the rope isn't too short with him, because there's going to be people who want Nick Foles, especially with Nick Foles making, $15 million, whatever the number is next year, to be the backup. That's a high number for a backup QB. So there's going to be people that want Nick Foles in there. So we just have to see if Trubisky gets a true chance to be successful in, a new system. And, you got a new tight end there in Jimmy Graham that a lot of people say that you overpaid a little bit, but he's somebody who can help out as well as far as just having a different weapon. So we'll see what the Bears do going into next year.
Yeah, that pick right there, I was mad at that. Nick Kwiatkowski, that's my guy. We call him Baby Keithley, so who went to the Raiders. So it just came back to me. So yeah, so that's the guy I hated that we lost. But Jimmy Graham, man, this dude had 20-something catches last year. Like, why would you get him? Like, what did he? He's, what, 36 years old, some 35, 34? He's older. He's, what, a 12, 13-year vet?
Yeah, it seemed like he'd been in the league for a minute.
See, that's the stupid stuff that makes me mad when we do stuff like that. Like, we need a tight end. But you pay him, he getting, what, almost, I forgot what it was, like, $9 million a year, something like that?
I think it says $9 million a year.
Come on. Yeah, we could have got another tight end, man. We could have got somebody else, like, we could have spent that on something else. Like, why? I don't know. That was nerve-wracking. So we had an up and down, like, you let Nick go. We didn't want him to leave. Prince, it was, I guess, maybe money-wise. But we get Robert Quinn. We get Nick Foles, good pickup. We get Mingo, Latavius Mingo. That was, I mean, he hadn't done anything, but he always had potential, so let's see what that happens. He's in a good defense. Maybe Mac gets him right. But it's been up and down with our offseason, man. But at this point, I'm just ready to see what we got and how it all fits in now because we've done it, so.
Yeah, and for the draft, where would you want to see the Bears go?
Knowing that we don't have any picks, like, we have to make it count. We don't have a pick until, I think it's the 40th and the 43rd pick. We have 2 second-round picks. And we have to I want to get another wide receiver and a lineman. I want to get an offensive lineman and another wide receiver.
Okay, now, this is a deep wideout draft, so you should be able to get a quality wide receiver in the second round. So I'm excited to see what the draft will bring. My man, Mr. Controversy, bringing it. So we're going to go ahead and take our first music break. I'm paying homage to different artists on every episode. So today we're going to take it back and pay homage to Tupac and give you some Tupac tracks, my favorite ones. And we'll be right back.
Can hardly spell her name. That's not our problem. That's up to Brenda's family. Well, let me show you how it affects our whole community. Now, Brenda really never knew her moms, and her dad was a junkie putting death into his arms. It's sad, cause I bet Brenda doesn't even know. Just cause you're in the ghetto doesn't mean you can't grow. But oh, that's a book. My own revelation. Do whatever it takes to resist the temptation. Brenda got herself a boyfriend. Her boyfriend was a cousin. Now let's watch the joy. And she tried to hide a pregnancy from a family who really didn't care to see or give a damn if she went out and had a church of kids. As long as when the check came, they got first dibs. Now Brenda's belly's getting bigger, but no one seems to notice any change in her figure. She's 12 years older, she's having a baby, in love with the molester who's sex and her crazy. And your aunt also thinks that'll be with her forever, and dreams of a world with the two of them are together. Whatever, he left her and she had the baby solo. She had it on the bathroom floor and didn't know, so she didn't know what to throw away and what to keep. She wrapped the baby up and threw him in a trash heap. I guess she thought she'd get away, wouldn't hear the cries. She didn't realize how much the little baby had her eyes. Now the baby's in a trash heap, bawling. Mama can't help her, but it hurts to hear her calling. Brenda wants to run away. Mama say you're making me lose pay, and social work is here every day. Now Brenda's gotta make her own way. Can't go to a family, they won't let her stay. No money, no babysitter, she couldn't keep a job. She tried to sell crack, but ended up getting robbed. So now what's next? It ain't nothing left to sell. So she sees sex as a way of leaving hell. It's paying her rent, so she really can't complain. Prostitute fell, swing. And Brenda's her name, she's got a baby.
Welcome back to The Real Deal with Damian Adams. Hopefully you enjoyed that music break. I am back, one man, Mr. Controversy. And we are about to count down our top five most rewatchable NFL games of all time. Now, when I was doing my research for this and trying to go through the different games, there's so many memorable NFL games, it made the list really hard to make. So for people out there, it's only 10 games we're going to pick between us. We're going to miss some. All right, so don't go crazy on us. Just let us know. You know, if you got one that you think was missed, leave a suggestion. That's all. Don't go too crazy on us. But we definitely would love to hear from you and about your most rewatchable games as well. So what we're going to do is have Mr. Controversy give us number five. I'll give my number five, so on and so forth. So, Mr. Controversy, what NFL game do you have as your number five most rewatchable game of all time?
You know what? The funny thing is, I didn't rank none of these. Like, but I will. The 2015 Seattle Seahawks versus the Pittsburgh Steelers. The Seahawks, they beat the Steelers 39-30. This was in Seattle, and 2015, they had just came off their loss in the Super Bowl, the Seahawks, and this was later on in the year, and it was like a wild game. You saw Richard Sherman follow AB everywhere he went. He followed him, right? Mm-hmm. Most of the game, held AB to... SB only had 54 yards. Sherman had an interception in this game, so that was big. Big Ben threw for 456 yards in the game, and he had one touchdown pass, though. Now, your man Marcus Wheaton, I don't know if people remember him, he went off that game. He had, I think, like, he had 21 yards and with nine catches, man, and the TD. On the other hand, Russell Wilson threw for 345 yards and five touchdowns. And James Baldwin. What's Baldwin's first name?
Oh,
Baldwin had 6 receptions, but 3 TDs. I was about to say James, though. But Baldwin had 6 receptions.
Doug Baldwin.
And I just remember the game just going back and forth. I remember Steelers had a two-score lead going into, like, third quarter, and Seattle just start clicking. Russell Wilson, you couldn't stop him. Jimmy Graham had a good game, then he ended up tearing his fibula. So, but I just remember that game was real exciting, going back and forth, especially with, at that time, they had the two best defenses in the game, and for them to explode like that. It was some great defensive plays as well, but that's my fifth game.
That's a good pick right there, especially when you think about exciting regular season games. That one does come to mind. Great quarterback matchup between Roethlisberger and Wilson. You mentioned Baldwin, Jimmy Graham out there, Antonio Brown, all the great weapons going against those great defenses. So that's a good pick at number five right there. For my number five, I went back to 2012, AFC divisional round between Baltimore and Denver. Denver was number one seed that year. They were hosting the Baltimore Ravens, who had just came off of a win in the wild card round. And this was a crazy back and forth game. Went to double overtime, which is something that you don't see in the NFL too often. You know, the playoffs, you can't have a tie. So that's the only time you see these type of events happen. The Ravens won 38-35. If you remember in the game, the biggest play, Joe Flacco throws, he shows his incredible arm strength in this game where he throws this crazy Hail Mary to Jacoby Jones, and he gets behind the defense to keep the game going and to force overtime. And Denver, for sure, probably had the better team. But Baltimore and Joe Flacco went on this crazy run. In this game, Joe Flacco went 18 for 34, 331 yards, 3 TDs. Ray Rice had 30 carries for 131 yards and one touchdown. Jacoby Jones had 2 receptions for 77 yards. 1 reception was 70 of that with the Hail Mary. Peyton Manning went 28 for 43, 290 yards, 3 touchdowns, 2 picks. Ronnie Hillman, remember that name? Had 22 carries for 83 yards in this one. And Eric Decker had 6 receptions for 84 yards for Denver. Classic matchup right there. I just remember going crazy watching this game go back and forth, not knowing who was going to win. And that throw by Joe Flacco to Jacoby Jones is one of the greatest plays in history. So that's my number five right there. What are your memories of that matchup?
I remember that because before the game, I was talking to one of my buddies. He's a big Denver Broncos fan. And he was like, yeah, man, you know, hey, man, I don't even think we got it. I said, bro, hold up. First of all, I don't doubt Flacco in the playoffs. Well, Flacco has always played well in the playoffs. And I was like, you got to understand. I said, and Chelp's my guy. I said, but Chelp is a beast, but you got to think about it, man. Chelp is not used to covering the speed with, who the hell? They had,
Torrey Smith, Jacoby Jones.
Torrey Smith.
Yeah.
Torrey Smith. And I was like, so, and it was like the first touchdown I played was long to Torrey Smith. And that year, Chelp had, I don't think no one caught a touchdown on him all year. And for Torrey to get, I think, 2 on him. And the biggest play, like you said, that crazy play, I went crazy when Flacco threw that pass, but I remember one of the biggest plays, of course, was the interception Peyton threw. And well, I think it was double overtime.
Yeah.
And I couldn't believe that, man. It was just like, that's when I knew then Baltimore might take this year. I had a feeling they were going to take it.
Yeah, no, I definitely had that feeling after that game that the Ravens just had a special run in them. And they definitely proved that after that game.
It was cold, too. Remember, it was like in a single digits. It was, like, very cold.
Yeah.
And they were talking about, was Manny going to wear a glove or not? I remember the build-up and everything in that game. Yeah, that was a big game. It was on a Saturday. I remember that game like it was yesterday. Yep.
Now, what do you have for your number four?
My number four game, I'm sticking with regular season, is the 2000, it was a Monday night game, week 15, and it was the Tampa Bay Buccaneers that was playing against the St. Louis Rams, and this is the year after, they called it the revenge game, this is the year after what Rams beat them to go to the Super Bowl, the NFC Championship, the score was like, what, 9 9-6, like the greatest defensive effort I've ever seen. You know, the way they shut down the Rams that year. But going to 2000, big game, still had some of the same players. Sean King was the quarterback for the Buccaneers. You know, Tampa Bay had been talking mess all long. St. Louis got lucky and a lot of back and forth, and it lived up to its hype, man. It was funny because it wasn't the defensive game that you thought, even though it was great defensive plays, but it was points also. Buccaneers won 38-35. Kurt Warner, man, he threw for 316 yards, but and two touchdowns, but had three interceptions. Threw for three interceptions. Marshall Faulk, being the guy who he is, had 79 yards rushing for three touchdowns. Then he had another touchdown receiving with 53 yards. It was like the running back went off in that game because Ward Dunn, I used to call him Lil Weezy, but Ward Dunn, man, he was like my favorite running back then. He ran for 145 yards and three touchdowns and also had 53 yards receiving. Sean King threw for 256 yards. He had two touchdowns, and he rushed for 58 yards also. So it was like a battle. It was a back-and-forth game, man. You think about all the big names you had in that game. I think that was a game. I'm wondering if that was a game where I think it was a game where I remember they picked up Falk, and he, like, sat there and picked him up and slammed him. Like, then it was a big play at the end. Sean King had the ball, and I think he was rushing for a touchdown, and he flipped it. Either he flipped it to Ward Dunn or vice versa, but I remember that he did like a little backward shovel pass, and they were able to get first down and score to win in the fourth quarter, late in the fourth quarter, so. And that was that's my fourth most rewatchable game.
Now, that's a really good game right there. I have to go back and rewatch that one again, just thinking about that and how it went back and forth. And you talked about Tampa Bay at that time, which is known for defense, and the fact that they was able to put up those points right in that game. Really, those games where you get the opposite of what you believe is going to happen is always a good thing, because it's like, okay, going to this matchup thing, it's going to be a defensive struggle, and you get that type of output, especially during that time. Like, today you get a 38, 30-something game is whatever. But back then you got, those type of points being put up wasn't the norm, especially against defensive teams. So that's a really good pick right there. For my number four, this one, I personally, if I rewatch it, I usually stop it at like the 10-second mark when 10 seconds are left in the fourth quarter. But I understand that this game is one of the most rewatchable games of all time. The 2017 NFC Divisional Round. Minnesota defeated the New Orleans Saints 29-24. It's also known as the Minnesota Miracle. So that's why Mr. Controversy was already laughing, because he knew once I said 10 seconds left what game I was talking about. So in this game, Vikings dominated the first half. Like, dominated the first half. First half and like half the way through the third quarter, they were just dominating. And the Saints made this great comeback starting midway through the third quarter in the fourth quarter. And the Saints got up after being down the whole game, got up by 1 point, 24-23, 10 seconds left. And I'm thinking this is in the bag. I'm like, oh, we made this great comeback. We going to play against Philly next week. We got this. And all we got to do, they ain't got no timeouts left. All we got to do is make a tackle inbounds. Or even if they get out of bounds, just make it to where they're not in field goal range. They're a long ways away. Like, it's not like they're close to field goal range. All we got to do is make a tackle inbounds. So the play happens. We got this weird lineup where we got people lined up on the sidelines to prevent them from going out of bounds. The play goes. Case King's back there. He got a lot of time. That's one thing I remember. He was back there forever. A lot of time. Throws the ball up. I see Stephon Diggs going to air. I see Marcus Williams behind him. in the moment, I'm thinking, all he got to do is push his legs. Push his legs. He goes down. He has no chance to get out of bounds, stop the clock. There's no chance they would get that far to be able to spike the ball in time. We win this game. And for some reason, Marcus Williams ducked like he heard gunshots and missed Stephon Diggs completely. And I was watching the game at my mother-in-law's house. And my mother-in-law hasn't seen me watch sports that much at this point. So she had never seen me get angry at anything. So needless to say, this was the first time my mother-in-law heard me curse. And threw my hat across the room. And I had never been so angry at a play in my life. For him to miss Stephon Diggs like that, and for Stephon Diggs to go just running, and you see nobody in front of him, and I'm like, there's no way he lost this game in this way. It was just, oh man, it was heartbreaking. But it was a great game. The reason I was so angry is that the fact that we came back, because honestly, it looked like we was going to get blown out. And the fact that we came back in that way, you know, Drew Brees led a great comeback. In that game, Drew Brees he went 25 for 40, 294 yards, 3 touchdowns. He had 2 picks in that game. Vikings had a really good defense that year as well. For us to be able to come back in that way and then lose made it even more heartbreaking, the fact that we came back against that defense. Case Keenum had a really good game that game. He went 25 for 40 as well, 318 yards, 1 touchdown, 1 pick. Stephon Diggs had 6 receptions for 137 yards, including, you know, the biggest reception of the game. Man, it was a great game. Not the greatest ending for me as a Saints fan, but it's definitely a rewatchable. What are your memories of that matchup?
Man, I was just thinking, like, Damian probably broke a TV. something. Because I remember we were in, where were we at? In Dayton. In, not Dayton, but Daytona Beach, because we was covering the Pro Bowl. I'm not Pro Bowl, but the Tropical Bowl. The game, you know, a little bowl game for college players that we always cover, the 3-point conversion. And so we got back to the house by then. And was that the first game? That was the first game, right?
What was the first game that day?
Wait, was that Sunday? It was Saturday or Sunday?
I want to say it was Sunday, because I believe...
No, it was Sunday because we just got done doing the Tropical Bowl.
Yeah,
it was Sunday, and because Pittsburgh just lost to Jacksonville, and we was watching that game. I never forget it, and I'm just like, man, this you know, Saints about to go. This is a great game, and me, I'm always the type that, if it's not over, it's not over. I mean, even in life, if the doctor say, you know, I always ask, if somebody's like, you know, on their deathbed or something happened, bad happened, it's like heart attack, whatever, I don't ask, I don't cry. First thing I ask the doctor, is there a chance? I don't know. I don't want to know the percentage. Is there a chance that they can live? That's how I am. So. Yeah. For me, to watch that game, I'm like, let me just see what happens. They coming back, something crazy, you know, maybe a Hail Mary. You never know. So when he threw that pass to Diggs, and I was just like, all right, you know, like, man, I'm thinking, did they have a timeout, did they?
No timeouts left.
So I'm like, Diggs, I'm like, when he caught, I'm like, we about to catch him. I'm like, man, he not about to get out of bounds. So, man, when the old boy missed that tackle, I jumped up like I was a Vikings fan because I couldn't believe it. I was just in shock. But immediately, I remember I leaned over and shot to Sherm. I looked at Sherm and I was like, my boy Sherm, I said, bruh, is this the Bears? and we were doing Airbnb. I said, bro, I would have cost us all money because I would have broke this TV. I can imagine. Like, I don't know how you. Man, I think you made a video or something. Like the next day or something. I don't know how you did that, Daniel. Like, still to this day, you get much props from me, bro. I can't even talk about. I don't know how you can talk about that. Like, I don't even like talking about the game. You tell me, the Bears played Tim Tebow, and Tebow beat us. Like, that game still, I hate talking about that game. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's so for you to bring this up, as that's crazy. I commend you, but that probably was one of the craziest finishes I've seen in all of sports.
Yeah, nah, it was definitely a crazy finish. It's one that they always going to rerun whenever they talk about crazy finishes. So it's something I have to get over, because it's always going to be shown. Whenever they talk about, the best finishes of all time and things like that, it's always going to show Stephon Diggs running into the end zone, throwing his helmet. So you're going to see him just that, that smooth look on his face, like he just, like it was nothing happened. So it's,
right.
Like I said, and then that guy.
Yeah, that's the thing, though. Like, I feel him. I feel you happy. I'd rather him went crazy, jumping up. Come on, dog. Don't look like you did something. Like, that was he missed. Dog, he blew a tackle. Don't look like this is what I do. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
You meant to do that. Like, you broke the tackle. You hurdled some. Nah, bro. Don't make that face. Like, that's what got me. You know what I'm saying? Like, I was mad over that. You know, I guess because the Bears, I don't like the Vikings like that. But I got mad over that when he did. Like, dog, you ain't calling like that. Like, anyway, yeah, bro, I remember that. But that was a crazy sentence, though.
Yeah, man, absolutely nuts. But like I said, it's a rewatch because it's such a great game and a great finish. And I just remember the feeling of seeing him in the air thinking, okay, he's got to jump up to catch this ball. There's no way he's going to be the guy out of bounds. And Marcus Williams, man, a good safety, a good player. But that play right there, man. Oh. But that was our number 5 and number 4 most rewatchable NFL games of all time. We're going to take a quick music break, give you some more Tupac. We come back, give you some more of our list. We'll be right back.
Wonder why they call you bitch. 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 Look here, Miss Thang, take this off your game, but you's a money younger woman and you need to check. In the locker room, all the homies do is laugh. High fives, cause another nigga played your ass. It was said you was sleazy, even easy, sleeping around for what you need. See, it's your thing and you can shake it how you wanna. Give it up free or make your money on the corner. But don't be bad, play the game, get mad at change. Then you wonder why these motherfuckers call your name. Still looking for a way out, and that's okay, I can see you in a stray, it's a way out. Keep your mind on your money. Enroll in school, and as the years pass by, you can show them fools. But you ain't trying to hear me, get you stuck. You're heading for the bathroom, about to get tossed up. Still looking for a rich man, you dug a ditch. Got your legs up, trying to get rich. I love you like a sister, but you need to switch. And that's why they called you bitch, I bet you. You wonder why they call you bitch. You wonder why they call you bitch, I bet you. You wonder why they call you bitch. You wonder why they call you bitch, I bet you. Your mama, cause you're heading for the club in a skin tight mini skirt, looking for some love. Got the legs wide open while you're sitting at the bar, talking to some nigga about his car. I guess he said he had a Lexus. What's next? You're heading to his car for some sex. I pass by, can't hold back tears aside, cause Lord knows, for years I tried. And all the other people on my block hate your guts. Then you wonder why they stare and call you slut. It's like your mind don't understand. You don't have to kill your dreams, plot schemes on a man. Keep your head up, legs closed, eyes open. Either a nigga wear a rubber or we die smoking. I'm hearing rumors, so you need to switch. And niggas wouldn't call you bitch, I bet ya. You wonder why they call you bitch. You wonder why they call you bitch, I bet ya. You wonder why they call you bitch. You wonder why they call you bitch, I bet ya. You wonder why they call you bitch. You wonder why they call you bitch, I bet ya. You wonder why they call you bitch. You wonder why they call you bitch. I guess time.
times getting hard, even harder for you. Cause hey now, got a baby on the way now. More money from the county, and thanks to the welfare, you about to get your hair done. You got a dinner date, can't be late. Trick or treat, sweet thing, got another trick to meet. Way did it, it was smooth. Blocking while he came with you. So baby, be proof. I should have seen it in the first case. The worst case, I should have never called you back in the first place. I remember back in high school, baby, you was fast, straight sex. When you move your ass. But now things change, cause you don't look the same. Let the ghetto get the best of you, baby, that's a shame. Called HIV, and now you're about to be deceased. And finally be at peace. So where you at now? Cause everybody left, they step, and left you on your own. See, I loved you like a sister, but you died too quick. And that's why I called you bitch, I bet you. You wonder why they call you bitch. You wonder why they call you bitch, I bet you.
Welcome back to The Real Deal with Damian Adams. Hopefully you enjoyed that music break. Still here with my man, Mr. Controversy, as we count down our top five most rewatchable NFL games of all time. Giving you something to do because we're all rewatching games right now. So we're giving you something, a list, you know, to go by of games that you should go in YouTube if you, you know, are looking for something to watch. So what is the number three game on your list?
The number three game... You know what? I had a few. I'm gonna change this because I'm not gonna lie. I hope I can say this. So I was putting in, and I had these on my list already. Like these some games I might go. I had on there what I would watch, like just my favorite. You know, my favorite.
Yeah.
But you know, since you pulled out the that game, so I almost was inclined to talk about when Kawhi Leonard hit the shot and it bounced up on the rim. I almost said that, but it's the top. That's it. But I'm gonna still go with one more regular season game. I'm gonna go with one more regular season game. It's a classic. And then I'm gonna go with the playoffs. But this one right here, 1994, was a Monday night game, Kansas City Chiefs versus the Denver Broncos. The Chiefs beat the Broncos 31-20, and I'm going to give you the stats first, and I'm going to tell you why it was crazy. So, first off, the stats, you look at Montana, he threw for 393 yards. Like, Montana was never that type of dude, you know, to throw for that many yards, but he threw for 393 yards and three touchdowns. Marcus Allen ran for 65 yards and 49 yards a season. Elway threw for 263 yards and two touchdowns, and he rushed for 30 yards. And Anthony Miller, at the time, was Denver's wide receiver, had five receptions for 99 yards and a touchdown. And Shannon Sharpe had four receptions for 50 yards. The reason why this game is one of the most rewatched games for me is because you had Elway and Montana. Now, because they played one AFC, NFC, you didn't see them play as much. They didn't play each other as much. Last time they played was in 90 in the Super Bowl when 49ers beat them 55-10, I'm sorry. But for this game, you knew it was coming down to Montana's maybe his last year playing for the Chiefs. Playing in the NFL because he was old, of course, broken now. But to see these two legends go at it. But it, you think about it now, you look at the legends, Montana, Elway, two Hall of Famers. Then you got a Hall of Fame running back in Marcus Allen. then you still got Shannon Sharp, a Hall of Fame tight end, was in his prime at that point, just getting into his prime. Then you had Derek Thomas playing. Don't forget Neil Smith. So you had all of, you had the great talent, the Hall of Famers, and they provided what you was looking for. The game was close. It kept going back and forth. And to me, like, I'm not the type of person. I talked about the Seattle-Pittsburgh game. It was 39-30. A lot of scoring, but like I said, it was defense as well. Buccaneers 38-35, but it was a lot of defense as well. But I'm not a type of person that just like offense. I'm the type of person that loves to live in a moment while watching the game, when I rewatch a game. So when I look at this game, I lived in a moment because just regular plays like a 5-yard run from Marcus Allen and dove and got the first down. Or Derek Thomas almost getting there with a sack and Elway able to, you know, beat him out and throw for a 15-yard first down. You know, stuff like that. It had a lot of that stuff in the game, a lot of drama. I remember Derek Thomas, he got suspended. They suspended him for the first quarter because he was late, which Derek Thomas was always late. But he was late to, I guess they had enough, he was late to one of the practices or one of the meetings, so he got suspended the first quarter. And I remember him pacing down the field in the first quarter, and Denver came off, you know, playing well early, and then he finally came in, and then stuff started to settle in. But it was going back and forth. Elway just came back and led Denver Broncos to a lead for like, I think it was like under 2 minutes left. But you see Elway do his thing, then Montana drive down the length of the field, man, and get a touchdown, throw a touchdown to Willie Davis with less than like 30 seconds left, I think it was, to win the game. You couldn't ask for nothing better than that. Then it was a prime game at that. Just, if you hadn't watched that game, it's on YouTube, go back and watch it. I promise you won't be disappointed. Like I said, you think of all the big names. They talked about the big names. They talked about how big it was at that time on Monday night. And Frank Gifford calling the game and Dan Dierdorf and everybody. It was just, that game is like a classic. Like I said, I know it's regular season, but if you want to look at greats and watch how great they were, the game to go look at.
Okay, now that definitely is one that I'll go back and rewatch when I got time. And what was the final score one more time?
That game was 31-28.
31-28.
Kansas City Chiefs.
Chiefs, Broncos, and you said that was 94?
Yep, Montana versus Elway, man. Classic duel, man. It was like I said, then just all the great names there, and everybody played a part, but it was just so much drama in that game leading up to it, and then late in the game, and Montana do what you always heard of Montana doing. The fact that we know John Elway is one of them guys that always came back in big games, but he did his part, man. Montana trumps him and gets a game-winning touchdown pass. It was crazy.
Now, that's a really good one. I'm going to have to go back and rewatch that one day. So for my number three, whenever there's a Saints rewatchable, normally it ends in heartbreak for Saints fans. And this is another one of those that I remember watching and, you know, saying some four-letter words afterwards. So 2011... NFC divisional round, San Francisco versus the Saints. The San Francisco 49ers beat the Saints 36-32. And this game, I remember because it was a game that it was good leading up to the fourth quarter. But then in the fourth quarter, late in the fourth quarter, it got crazy. So the score was 23-17, San Francisco, with like 4 minutes left in the game. And it ended 36-32. Like, it went nuts the last 4 minutes. And I remember Jim Harbaugh just doing a great job for the 49ers in that game, calling a great game. I remember one play he called where he did a quarterback sweep with Alex Smith, which has caught the Saints totally off guard.
and Alex Smith just walked into the end zone on a QB sweep, which you don't see too often. Like, just the shotgun, quarterback got the ball, and it was like a running back sweep, but just the quarterback going out to the outside running. And people forget how athletic Alex Smith was. Hopefully he can still be one day after that leg injury. But how athletic he was. And, you know, dude ran like a 4.5, 4.6, and got around that corner and was gone. And one of those, one of the plays that led to the Saints having to keep coming back. And this was, speaking of Jimmy Graham like we did earlier, so this 2011, this is when Jimmy Graham was doing his thing. So Jimmy Graham had a monster game that game. The 49ers had no answer for him. He had 103 yards receiving, had a big 66-yard catch, which Saints fans like myself thought, put us ahead, we're going to be good to go. And with 9 seconds left, Alex Smith hits Vernon Davis on a post route down the middle. Vernon Davis gets hit by two Saints, holds on to the ball, catches it, comes up, takes it off, he's crying. It's just like when Steve Young hit Terrell Owens in the wild card round some years earlier in the 99, when Steve Young hit Terrell Owens for the game winning, Terrell Owens came off crying. It was exactly like that, you know, except the quarterback was right-handed. That was pretty much the only difference. And, you know, Vernon Davis comes off crying. And the only difference is Steve Mariucci is a little bit more of, you know, an emotionally available guy than Jim Harbaugh. So when Steve Mariucci and Terrell Owens comes off crying, Steve Mariucci comes up and gives him a hug. When Jim Harbaugh gave a hug to Vernon Davis, it was like somebody giving a hug, and you could tell he didn't really want to do it. It was like he was like, you know, yeah, man, now give me a, it wasn't like the most touching hug that you'll see from a coach to a player. But it was a great game. One that, like I said, the last 4 minutes was just crazy. To give you some stats, Alex Smith went 24-42, 299 yards, 3 touchdowns, had 28 rushing yards. That one rush that I talked about, the QB sweep, great play call. That was a touchdown on that play. Frank Gore, who's still in the league today, 13 carries, 89 yards. Vernon Davis, who would still be in the league, you know, he just retired, had 7 receptions for 100 and that was 180 yards, 2 touchdowns. He went crazy that day. Drew Brees went 40 for 63. That was part of the problem. I don't know why he wasn't running the ball at all. 462 yards, 4 touchdowns, 2 picks. Darren Sproles had 15 receptions for 118 yards. Jimmy Graham, like I mentioned, 103 yards. And Marcus Colston had 136 yards and 1 touchdown. What are your memories of this matchup?
Man, I remember just the end when, because it got real crazy. And like you said, I remember the long run with Alex Smith, and I'm thinking, like, the heck are they doing? You know, that was crazy. But to me, when he threw that pass to Jimmy Graham, it was Jimmy Graham, right, for the long touchdown?
Yeah.
And I remember calling my boy, like, oh, my God. This is like the greatest game I've ever. And then, like, come back again with Alex Smith. Man, I just felt bad for the Saints. It was one of those plays, like, it was one of those games, like, somebody had to lose.
Yeah.
And, you know, you didn't want none of them to lose, but somebody had to lose. And sure enough, like you said, it's always the Saints. But it was just, that game showed how much both teams wanted it. Like, and football is always like that, especially the playoffs. But for this particular game, I don't know if I've ever seen it in another game like I did in this game, where both teams wanted it so badly. And man, it was just, I'll never forget that. I would never forget that, man. The last 3 touchdowns, it was just like, this is crazy. Like, yeah, that was a great game. I forgot about that, man. That was a great game.
Yeah, no, that one was a great game. I have one of my best friends is a 49ers fan,
and we were watching the game together. And when Jimmy Graham caught that touchdown, his spirit was crushed. He thought it was done. And like I said, in typical Saints fashion, when it comes to this last decade, if we can lose the game in a crazy way, we will do it. And that's what happened in this one. So yeah, it was a that one was crazy, man. I remember, and I know it was crazy because I was sweated through my shirt, like watching the last 4 minutes. I had a gray Saints shirt, and I sweated through it. I was like, because afterwards, I'm trying to remember what time it was, but they wanted to do something. I was like, man, I got to take a shower and everything, man. So,
that was a Saturday night. I remember that because we went to go watch Pittsburgh play, got who they played. It was a Pittsburgh game. It was a game earlier that night, and then I came back to watch that 49ers game, and I remember watching it we were going crazy. Yeah, that was crazy. That was a great game, man. I remember that. Wow, I forgot about it, but you bringing it back, yeah, that was a crazy game.
So what game do you have at number two?
All right. This game, it involved one of the teams, and not the Saints. So I'm not going to break your heart anymore tonight. I started to mess with you and bring up the 2006 NFC Championship game, the Bears and the Saints, but just to mess with you. But this was 2002. This is the wild card game. The 49ers played the New York Giants.
Oh, I remember this one, yeah.
Yeah. Giants, it was crazy because, well, let me go over the stats first, like we always do. But with the stats, Kerry Collins was the quarterback. He threw for 342 yards and 4 touchdowns. Right, and Tiki Barber had 115 yards rushing with a touchdown, and he had 62 yards receiving. Jeff Garcia threw for 331 yards and 3 touchdowns, and then and he ran for 60 yards and a touchdown. Jeff Garcia was a beast. And Terrell Owens had 9 catches for 177 yards and 2 touchdowns. And what I remember about this game was, you knew it was going to be crazy because it was like the first 5 minutes, Terrell Owens caught a pass for 76 yards for a touchdown, broke a tackle, and went to the house. And it was just like, oh, man, 49ers about to kill him. It was like after that, man, Giants just went on this run. I remember when one of the biggest plays, what was cold, was Shockey. I love Shockey. Early in the game, Shockey got blindsided by a linebacker, I think it was. He got blindsided by a linebacker. So, because of that, Shockey, so late in the first quarter, they threw a pass to Shockey. Shockey caught the pass. They on the 49ers, like, 18-yard line, right?
Mm-hmm.
Shockey had a chance to score. Threw the pass to him, then he slipped the tackle, and had a straight line to the end zone, right? Instead of going to the end zone to score, easy score, he goes at an angle towards the middle of the field for the dude that hit him just to try to run him off. Like, what? I would never forget that. I had a touchdown, man. And watch him. Instead of going straight ahead, he goes towards the middle, and I would never forget that. But
yeah, Shockey was different, man.
Yeah, I used to love Jimmy Shockey, one of those type of games. But and then he had a 2-yard touchdown, man. Giants jumped out to a 38-14 lead.
Yeah.
This is a playoff game. And then after that, man, 49ers just Terrell Owens, I'm media now, if I got to say his name right. Terrell Owens caught another touchdown pass. Jeff Garcia ran for one. It was like, No, I'm sorry. He ran for one, like I stated earlier. And 49ers just kept building this momentum and came all the way back. And then with the Giants driving the last few seconds, like 11 seconds left, they was kicking the field goal. And I just forget it because if they, you know, of course they kicked the field goal, they would win the game. And when they went to hike the ball, it was a bad snap. So the holder got the ball. He's holding the ball up, letting everybody know. And next thing you know, he throws it downfield. Now, remember, as you're watching it on the screen, you don't know what he's doing. All you know is you see him, like normal, the bad snap, they hold the ball up like, hey, I got the ball, let me throw it. And then next thing you know, he just heaves it downfield. You're kind of thinking, what is he doing? And all of a sudden, you see one of the linemen out there, offensive lineman out there, got a chance to catch the ball, but he's probably not going to catch. He's a lineman. But then he gets hit well before the ball gets there, which means, I mean, well before. Like, if y'all don't remember this, you talk about the, I hate to bring this up, Damian, but the supposed-to-be P.I. on the, who was it? That was playing against y'all. One of the Rams.
Yeah.
Remember when he hit your guy?
Mm-hmm.
This was worse than that. Like, he tackled dude and everything, and the ball wasn't even there, of course. So all of a sudden, we all thinking it's going to be a penalty, and the refs don't call it. Which it should have been a penalty, but the refs don't call it. But at the same time, after everything, you realize that they would have had to call the penalty on a lineman because he wasn't supposed to be down the field like that. You know, it was an ineligible man down the field. But yet still, for that to happen, you would have thought that it was blatant, but they didn't call anything, man. And they just let the game go. And the Giants, I would never forget that. They lost that game. 38-14 lead and blew it. It was crazy. One of the craziest games I ever saw.
Yeah, man, that was a crazy comeback. Crazy game. I remember the scene that comes to mind for me. In the middle of the comeback, Terrell Owens scores a touchdown. And they're still down by a lot. And he's celebrating like he does. And Michael Strahan comes over to him and points up at the scoreboard.
Right, right. Yep.
Yeah, like, look at the score. And
there was a lot of dramatics in that game.
Yeah.
A lot of drama, dramatic plays, and yeah.
But, yeah, I definitely remember that scene right there. And like I said, it was a great game, great comeback. Jeff Garcia, you guys did a great interview with Jeff Garcia on a 3-Point Conversion Sports Lounge. That was a couple episodes ago. And he's somebody who definitely doesn't get his just due for his time in the league and what he did. You know, especially because he followed Montana Young, and then it was him, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like because of that, he doesn't get his just due as being a very good QB during his time. And even after he left San Francisco, he had a couple years in there where he was good. You know, it kind of gets lost
right after
his San Francisco time, but he was a really good quarterback. And that was a very good game. Great game to watch.
Hey, yeah. Can I say this?
Yeah.
Like, it was also one of those games where, like, an old man, don't lie until you hadn't been, because the old man has been there. You know how you watching the game, and like I said, it was down 24, and they come back and they win the game. And on that play after they win, you know, everybody going crazy. One of them games where you get wide eyed, like, you know, your eyes wide, trying not to cry. They saying, we are, you know, whatever they saying, you know, you try.
I think every sports fan has been there. Every sports fan has had a moment. Where
that was it for me.
Yeah, every sports fan's had that moment. For me, it was when the Saints won Super Bowl. When Tracy Porter caught the interception to seal the game. I remember I was watching. I was in the Navy at the time. And my homegirl, who's a Saints fan too, she came up to give me a hug. And I had to keep my head up because I didn't want her to see me.
Wait.
You know, was,
you know what game that was for me in football? The other game was like that?
What? Which one?
When Brett Favre's his father just passed.
Oh, man. Yeah. Nah, that was a tearjerker. Yeah, that was a tearjerker.
The funny thing was, I'm over there trying my best, you know, eyes wide, playing it off, trying to let the wind hit it, turning my head. My father go to the bathroom. My father, we was watching the game together. He coming out the bathroom, coming him. This dude got big crocodile tears. Yeah. Oh, man. But, yeah, that 49, that was it for me. I ain't gonna lie.
Yeah, nah, like I say, everybody got to be real, man. We all had, like I said, if you're a big sports fan, you had those moments where you're like, why is this game making me feel like this? But because we are so invested, that's what happens. So, yeah, we've all had those moments. So, now, this game that I'm about to bring up at number two for me probably makes Seahawks fans cry a little bit. Talking about Super Bowl 49. So, for you guys who do not remember Super Bowl 49, this was Patriots versus Seahawks. Patriots defeated the Seahawks 28-24. Now, Seattle was up by 10 points going into the fourth quarter, right? And Tom Brady does a great job, and, you know, Seattle's defense is starting to wear down. They are able to score points. Seattle goes on this drive where you think for sure they're about to win, especially after it was Kurse who made this crazy, Javon Kurse makes this crazy circus catch on a deep throw from Russell Wilson, and they get to like the 5 or 6 yard line. They get down a couple more yards right there at the goal line. And this decision or bad decision has become a meme, has become something that people make fun of now, probably for the rest of time. When somebody makes a bad decision, they're going to compare it to Pete Carroll not running the ball with Marshawn Lynch at the 1-2 yard line, wherever it was. They decide to run a pass play, a pick for Russell Wilson to throw the ball. And a lot of people don't give enough credit to Brown on this play. So the cornerback for New England sees the play, sees the route, jumps it, makes this great interception. A lot of people just, you know, get stuck on the decision not to run. But most cornerbacks aren't making that play. Like, when they set that pick for him to run that slant right there, most cornerbacks are not able to get in position fast enough to stop that. So a lot of people have to give more credit to Malcolm Brown when it comes to making that interception, right? And the Patriots literally snatch victory from the jaws of defeat in this one with the interception to seal the game. Just to go over some stats, you got Russell Wilson, who went 12 for 21, 247 yards, 2 touchdowns, 1 pick, the big one. Marshawn Lynch had 102 yards on 24 carries with 1 touchdown. Man, remember Chris Matthews? My man.
He balled out that game.
He balled out that game, and that was pretty much it. Like, I thought for sure.
Hey, I thought he was going to be a beast. Yeah, me too.
I was like, this dude about to be a beast, because he was like 6'4". Like, he just looked the part, and he was out there making tough, like, contested catches, balling out. He had 4 receptions for 109 yards, 1 touchdown in that game. Tom Brady went 37 for 50, 325 yards, 4 touchdowns, 2 picks. Julian Edelman had 9 receptions for 109 yards, 1 touchdown. Gronk had 68 receiving yards for 1 touchdown. This was, like I said, a great game. Both defenses showed up. Like, it wasn't just some offensive explosion. You had plays where both the defenses and offenses made great plays. And like I said, that fourth quarter, you can see Seattle's defense got a little wore down. And that's why the Patriots are able to, you know, score their points. But the Seahawks had their chance at the end and honestly should have won the Super Bowl. What are your memories of this matchup?
I'd say the biggest play in that game was it first quarter, first or second quarter? Patriots were driving down. And Tom Brady threw an interception and near the goal line, like maybe in the end zone. Jeremy Lane picked it off, caught the ball in the end zone, took it off, took it out and ran it for like 17, 20 yards. It wasn't just because he got the interception. Jeremy Lane broke his arm on that play.
It was nasty, too.
And
I remember that.
For the rest of the game. Yeah, he was out for the rest of the game. And he was a nickelback. That was huge. And after that, you know, even though New England was driving them, but still, that was a big loss for the Seahawks. But what I remember the most was, I remember the play before the game. I remember telling everybody, you could probably look it up too on social media if you find it, but I remember saying, before the Super Bowl, this is probably going to be, it's going to be a great game because, first of all, Patriots always going to let, every game, Super Bowl, Patriots game, it's going to be close. I don't care who they play at. That's just how they, it's always going to come down to like the last possession or something. But I was saying that you got the two quarterbacks, the two most clutch quarterbacks going against each other. Like, either of these quarterbacks, you don't want to have the ball at the end of the game. Who's it going to be? I kept saying it, kept talking about it all week. So it gets down to that. Brady does what he do. Then Russell comes back. And, you know, Russell, my favorite quarterback, I'm like, here we go. And sure enough, the first pass to Marshawn, and Marshawn, like a 40-yard, something yard play, like that was the first play, which is real big, up the sidelines. Then he throws that incredible play to, I think it was Javon Curtis that made that crazy catch.
Yeah.
After that, they run the ball. Lynch gets stopped at the 2-yard line. I'm like, okay, it's over, you know. They throw the ball, it was a pick. When it happened, it was like it didn't happen. Yeah. I was waiting for either a flag or I was waiting for somebody, but all right, man, we just playing. We just playing with y'all. We about to start. Like, I was waiting for something, like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And, bruh, I didn't sleep well that night. I remember everybody I talked to was like, yo, I couldn't sleep. Not even Russell fans was just like, yo. And I wasn't saying it because I was Russ. A big Russ fan, but it was just like, yo, something just didn't sit right the way the game ended. You know what
yeah.
I'm saying? Like, it wasn't fair. Now, I will say, though, it was a great play. But think about it, man. That was Russell's third year in the NFL. That would have been his second Super Bowl win in 3 years.
Mm.
People forget about that. People forget about that. People talk about what Mahomes did is crazy. But I'm like, Russell, his first year, his rookie year, he has, what, 30, he ties the record for most touchdowns, a rookie quarterback. That same year, going to playoff, come back to beat Washington, come back down 20, take the lead over the Falcons with less than, what, like 20-something seconds left, 13 seconds left, and the Falcons come back. I scored a winning field goal with less than at the game ending, you know, at the buzzer or whatever, or the clock ends, they kick a field goal to win the game. After Russ came back to take the lead with like 13 seconds left or whatever it was, it's rookie year. And then sophomore year, they win the Super Bowl. And his third year, that could have been his back-to-back Super Bowl, which would have never been done in history. And it ends like that. So it was, I remember that, man. That was sad, man. I just watched the game a couple of weeks ago after when we was on our, you know, we first started doing our quarantine, that was the first time I ever watched that game because I couldn't watch it.
Yeah.
I couldn't watch it.
Nah, that was, like
great
I said.
Great game, though.
Yeah, great game. Tough ending for the Seahawks. Like you said, it didn't sit right because it just feels like they should have been back-to-back champs. Even if, you know, then people started coming out with the conspiracy theories that they didn't want to give Lynch the ball because they didn't want Lynch to be MVP. Like, come on, man. Mm-hmm. They made the wrong decision. Or you can just say the play was great. Like, because, like I said, most times the cornerback does not make that play. Like, 99% of the time they don't make that play. And they talked about later how they studied tape for that play. Like, Bill Belichick told Brown to be ready for that play when it comes. And he was ready, you know. So that's yeah.
And people don't realize too, man. I follow, like I said, I'm a big fan of you know, the Seahawks or Russell, and they used to, I remember they used to always, when they get to the goal line, and, you know, I hate comparing real life to fantasy. And I remember every time I had Marshawn Lynch, every time they would get to the goal line, they would always throw the ball. I'm like, why are they doing this? They would always do that during the season, so it was something that they did.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Nah, man, great game.
Yeah, that was great,
Great game. So we are now down to our number one. But we're not just going to give it to you. We got to do the old trick, leaving you, you know, with the hanger so that you come back for more. So we're going to give you a music break real quick. Then we're going to come back with our number one most rewatchable games of all time. Then, of course, recap our list and close out the show. So we're going to take a quick music break, give you some more Tupac. We'll be right back.
Inside my childhood when it's my heart die. And even though we both came from the same places, the money and the fame made us all change places. How could it be through the misery that came to pass? The hard times make a true friend afraid to ask for currency, but you can run to me when you need. And I never leave, honestly, someone to believe in. As you can see, it's a small thing to a truth. What could I do? Real homies help you get through. And coming new, he'd do the same thing if he could. Cause in the hood, true homies make you feel good. And half the times we be acting up, call the cops, bringing a cease to the peace that was on my block. And never stopped when my mama asked me, will I change? I tell her, yeah, but it's clear I'll always be the same until the end of time.
Hey, these broken wings, I need your hands to come and heal me once again.
Until the end of time. My heart stares seem to scare all my sister's kids. So you know, I don't hang around the house much. This all night, money making got me out of touch. Shit, ain't flashed a smile in a long while. An unexpected birth, worse of the ghetto child. My attitude got me walking solo. Ride all alone in my Lolo. Watching the whole world move in slow-mo. For five times disappear, listen to the ocean. Smoking boys, think my thoughts, then it's back to posting. Who can I trust in this cold world? My phony homie had a baby by my old girl. But I ain't tripping, I'm a player, I ain't sweating him. My sexy sister had a monkey like a Mexican. His Mexican, no remorse, it was meant to happen. Besides rapping, only thing I did good was rapping.
So
until the end of time.
Hey, these broken wings, I need your hands to come and heal me once again.
Until
so I can
time.
Fly.
An outlaw all along, remain strong in this planet full of player haters. They conversate with death row full of demonstrators. And in the end, drinking Hennessy made all my enemies envy me. So cold when I flow, eliminating easily. Fall to their knees, they plead for their right to bleed. I'm begging me to keep the peace. What I can see, closer to achieve. In times of danger, don't freeze. Time to be a G. Follow my lead, I supply everything you need. An ounce of game and the training to make a G. Remember me as an outcast outlaw. Another album out, that's what I'm about. More getting raw to the day I see my casket buried as a G, while the whole world remembers me until
Lord,
the end of time.
These broken wings, need your hands to come and heal me once again,
until the end of time.
Away, 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 away,
will always stay
until the end of time.
Welcome back to The Real Deal with Damian Adams. Hopefully you enjoyed that music break. I am back with my man, Mr. Controversy, who's been killing it like he always does on this episode. And now it's time for us to give you our number one most rewatchable games of all time, NFL. What game do you have at the number one spot, Mr. Controversy?
The number one game I have... It's funny you bring up that Seattle game, because, and this is more personal to me, it was a game before that when the Seahawks got into the Super Bowl when they played the Packers.
The famous onside kick game.
Yeah, the Packers, it's funny because it wasn't a... Aaron Rodgers didn't have a great game, but he only threw for like 170-something yards. Like, Seattle's defense was balling, but they were able to get field goals. He had a horrible game, but yet still, Packers was able to get field goals. And Russell Wilson had a bad game. He threw, five interceptions that game.
Oh, wow.
And he couldn't he just couldn't get it right. I mean, shoot, we're talking about can't get it right. And it was like something was up. And I remember watching the game, I kept believing, Russ, I believe they get Russ could do this because that's how he is. And then I remember late in the game, Green Bay got up, and I think the score was 19-7. And it just picked him off. He had four interceptions that game, I'm sorry. So, four interceptions. And I remember, so I'm like, all right, this is about to be a wrap, you know what I'm saying? And Green Bay, all Green Bay got to do is run the clock out. But sure enough, Russell Wilson got the ball back. They stopped Green Bay and came down, drove all the way down the field. Russ scored on a 1-yard touchdown run. And then the star kick. Usually, I didn't believe that Seattle was going to come back with the onside kick. You know what I'm saying? Because that don't happen. It usually don't happen in football. When you need one, that it just doesn't. In a playoff game like that, of that magnitude, and your boy, I want to be the hero. Let me do it. And sure enough, he jumped in front, I think it was Jordy. He jumped in front of us.
Yeah.
Fumbled the ball and everything. But that was horrible. But Seattle got it. And then they drove down and got a touchdown. And then the two point conversion, when they were able to, it was like a busted play in a sense, but it was still able to throw it. And, I think Marshawn scored a touchdown, and they threw it to the tight end for like the busted play, and he caught it for the 2-yard play or whatever. But and you could just see, and Green Bay had to come back, and they came back, drove all the way down to kick a field goal to tie it, right? Then it went into overtime, and everybody was talking about the wide receivers of the Seattle Seahawks, they're horrible, and then they threw a pass, and it was It was a long touchdown. I call that the James Baldwin. That's when he kind of broke out.
Yeah, Doug Baldwin.
James Baldwin. Doug Baldwin, when he kind of broke out and is, you know, and was able to be that guy, but like the third play in overtime, something like that, Russell threw a long pass all the way down, and of course they won the time, man. And it was just like, you know, this dude is destined to win a Super Bowl, man. Like, Russell Wilson, he might be the second chosen. I used to always compare him to Montana, and for him to do it that way, to beat Green Bay, now, this is what, 2 years, I think it was 2 years after the Hail Mary, and then he comes in and he does this. So it was like, I didn't feel for Green Bay, I was happy, but I mean, just a football fan, they probably felt, you got to feel for, you know, Aaron Rodgers and the Green Bay Packers and how that happened. They had a game won and all that happened, but it was just like, it was almost the closest thing to what happened in Minnesota when New Orleans lost, because it wasn't just because of, okay, Seattle made plays to get back in the game, but it wasn't just because of that.
Yeah.
It was a blunder by the one dude that tried to jump in and, like, bro, that wasn't even your, like, everybody knows when a ball comes, you let it come to the guy that's designated. The wide receiver is not using your special teams. He's going to be the guy that catches the ball. And sure enough, your boy, like I said, he fumbles the ball. And it was like, you just knew then, like, Seattle was going to win that game. And like I said, for him to get there, and that was going to be a second chance, second time getting the Super Bowl in 3 years and win it. It was like, I would never forget that game, man. I stood up the whole game watching that guy. I didn't sit down. And I felt like I was almost turned into a Seattle fan, because that's how much I love Russell Wilson. And I hate Green Bay, so it was like the perfect scenario. You know what I'm saying? And for that to happen, man, oh, my God, that was great. That was great. I would never forget that. Matter of fact, that was the year that Green Bay, Aaron Rodgers came back from being hurt and beat the Bears to make it to the playoffs.
Oh, so you had even extra hate.
Yeah. So that's my number one most rewatchable game.
No, that's a great game right there. That's one that kind of gets forgotten when you talk about, like, the great games. People remember, of course, the backup tight end who, I can't remember his name because I don't think he was in the league after that. Honestly, so the backup tight end, I think he got cut that offseason. I don't think he got picked up. So that mistake really cost him a lot. People talk about that game. But so he makes the blunder. Seattle gets a chance. They take advantage of it and come back. And for Green Bay, it's always a big what if, because that team they had that year, I think, matched up well with the Patriots and could have beat the Patriots in Super Bowl. And you know, people always wonder if, you know, what happens if you get a Aaron Rodgers versus Tom Brady type Super Bowl, you know, how would it go, even though quarterbacks don't face each other, but that's how people like to, you know, market it. So
it's a
big what if. It's one of the biggest what ifs in NFL history, is if the Packers would have made the Super Bowl that year, like pretty much like they were supposed to, what would have happened in that Super Bowl, especially with the Patriots.
Right.
You know, being that matchup. So that's a really good pick right there. I like that pick at number one. For my number one, speaking of the Patriots, so the reason this game is so rewatchable to me that I'm about to bring up, it was my senior year of high school, and I was starting to mold into what I wanted to do, right? Like, still had hoop dreams playing basketball, but I knew I wasn't going to make it pro. So I was like, what am I going to do? And I started getting really good at molding my opinions on sports.
And this Super Bowl, I remember as like my first hot take, quote unquote, that I got right. So it was Super Bowl 42. You had the undefeated New England Patriots going against the New York Giants. And I was the only dude out of all the people that would argue about sports at school. I was the only dude picking the Giants in this game. And the reason I was picking the Giants, they played in the regular season that year. And the Giants were one of the only teams that hung with the Patriots that year during the regular season. If I remember correctly, the Patriots only won the game by 3 points. And people at my school and even, you know, grown-ups and national media guys were kind of ignoring that result in the regular season, saying, oh, this is a Super Bowl. This team is the greatest team that we've ever seen. We don't think this game's going to be close, or, you know, Patriots will win comfortably. And I just remember thinking, they stayed that close to them the first time. They get a chance to adjust. They get a chance. They've seen this offense. And that defense was playing out of his mind in the playoffs, especially the defensive line. I remember thinking, okay, they're going to be able to get pressure on Tom Brady. And you only can get the ball to Randy Moss and Wes Welker if you have time. And I thought the Giants would be able to make it very uncomfortable with Tom Brady and win this game. And now this game had a lot of crazy stuff that had to happen for Giants to win. You had to have the crazy play where Eli Manning is about to get sacked. He's getting pulled on by three different people. Throws it. Maxwell has his eyes closed. He throws it up. David Tyree catches it. And David Tyree is known for having terrible hands. He could barely hang on to the ball. Has to pin it to his helmet with he had the safety on him who works for NBC now. Why is his name slipping my mind? Rodney. What's Rodney's last name on NBC, man? The safety. You have Derek Tony Dungy.
Harrison.
Okay, yeah, Harrison.
Rodney Harrison.
So Rodney Harrison is draped all over him. He catches the bottle, you know, pinned to his helmet. You had the fact that Tom Brady was not comfortable the whole game. He got sacked 5 times. And so he got sacked 5 times. I mean, he got hit, you know, at least 10, 15 times, pressured so many times in this game where he wasn't comfortable. Tom Brady in this game went 29 for 48, 266 yards, 1 touchdown. I mentioned the 5 sacks. Wes Welker was the go-to guy, 11 receptions for 103 yards. Randy Moss had 5 receptions for 62 yards, 1 touchdown. I do remember at the end of this game being scared that Tom Brady was going to hit Randy Moss for a long pass. Because no matter like how much defense you had, you couldn't stop Randy Moss from getting behind you. Now, I remember a few plays towards the end of this game where he just threw the ball deep to Randy. And it looked like Randy was going to catch the ball and just go into the end zone for the win. And they couldn't connect. But Randy was able to get behind the defense every time, even though they were prepared for this play. Because Randy was just, at you know, as far as wide receivers, probably the greatest athlete to ever be at a position. Eli Manning went 19 for 34, 255 yards, 2 touchdowns, 1 pick. You had Amon Toomer, 6 receptions for 84 yards. David Tyree, of course, had 3 receptions for 43 yards, 1 touchdown. You also had Plexico Burris with the game-winning touchdown in this one. He only had 2 receptions in this game. It was definitely a defensive game. And you got to think about the Patriots' offense that year. They had one of the greatest offenses of all time. And that Giants defense was able to hold them 14 points. But you also got to give Eli credit as well for getting the game-winning drive and hitting Plexico in the corner of the end zone. Just a great, memorable game. Like I said, I just remember it as well because of it was when I first started thinking about like my opinions and how to mold them and having being an unpopular opinion, something that we're doing now with the three-point conversion. That was one of my first unpopular opinions, saying the Giants would beat the Patriots and being able to, like I said, go about proving my point a certain way and then actually getting it right. So that's why that one is the most rewatchable game to me. What are your memories of this game?
I said it also that the Giants was going to win the game. I said it too, and because I said it first because the last game of the regular season, the Giants was the one that gave them the most trouble.
Yep.
You know, that game, it looked like the Giants was about to beat them, and it was crazy. But was that the last game of the season? Last game or next to the last game of the season? Either or. But I remember it just looked like the Giants was for real. And then Giants went on a run. They beat San Fran. I mean, not San Fran. They beat Tampa in Tampa. Then they go to Dallas, and they beat the Cowboys, who was the favorite. Then they go to Green Bay, the Lambeau. Cold, Tom Coughlin's face is red. He, you know, look like he about to die. You know, hoping somebody go check her. I was scared of him for his life, for real. And Plexico was killing him. Elon Plexico, and then dude kept missing the field goal for the Giants, and then finally, he missed like two field goals, and then finally he hit that game winner. But, so I was like, yo, like the Giants, first of all, the Giants probably the only team to get pressure on Brady. You know, but Eli's just, he's just tough. Like, they just tough. They just look like they tough. And sure enough, man, it was like, you know, it was a lot of drama in that game. And like I said, I'm one of them types. The game wasn't exciting as far as throughout the whole game, but I love football, so I love the, like I said, I love the little play that people don't talk about, you know, 2 yard loss or the stop that just stopped them enough so they couldn't make the first down or whatever. Of course, the Tyree play was crazy, but still, just to see the Giants, it just looked like they wouldn't let up. Like, you was kind of nervous, like you said, like they might get it tomorrow, so they couldn't do it. So I would never forget that. That was big. That was a big game. I think that was a game that kind of, you know, I know you felt like he shouldn't make the Hall of Fame. I don't, you know, I say he probably will get in, but I think that was a game that kind of, you start looking at Eli a different way. Like, maybe, you know what I'm saying? Maybe he is a great, you know, for him to do this. So, yeah, that was a big game.
Now, he definitely had a very good game in this one. He's had great moments in those two Super Bowl runs, or two of the greatest runs, period, right? For me, my issue is the inconsistency throughout his career. I feel like he's been more bad than good throughout his career. But I get why, especially Giants fans. Like, Giants fans, when I put up that post of, you know, my opinion on Eli Manning, you know, not being in the Hall of Fame or should not be in the Hall of Fame, you know, they really got after me. I get it for them because, you know, he led them to two Super Bowls. So I get that, of course.
Right.
But for me, like I said, my thing with Eli is the lack of consistency. And there's never been a time, unless you're a Patriots fan, if you were facing the Giants, there's never been a time where you were like, man, we playing Eli Manning tonight. It's going to be hard. There was never a time where you felt like that going against Eli Manning. Like I said, unless you are a Patriots fan after that Super Bowl. But before that, you were never going to say, man, Eli, that dude's elite. He's out here beasting. Like, it was a joke. Like, the people who would say Eli was elite, it was a joke because you can't spell elite without Eli. Like, it was something like that. But you would never say it in a serious way, like, Eli is one of the best quarterbacks in the league. And I'm not saying that you have to be top three in the league to be Hall of Famer, but you should at least be in the top five conversation, top 10.
Right.
And he's never been one of those guys. Like, when you look at his stats, like, one guy, when I put up that post, I responded to him. I said, when has Eli ever been great? So he took a screenshot of Eli's stats, and he circled 2 years. So in the 14 years he's been a starter, you circle 2 years where you believe his stats were quote-unquote great. And even those 2 years, the stats are just above average. They're what the other great quarterbacks, his peers, have done year in and year out, right? So for me, it's like it has to be a consistency thing.
Yeah, no, I agree. And that's why I say, like, that Patriots game, that was a game where it was like, okay,
yeah,
this dude might have something that nobody else has. This guy might it's a certain toughness he has, physically and mentally. And he don't, like Michael Strahan always talks about, I didn't make any faces, just had his look. But I think that was a game that showed, like, okay, maybe we might be wrong about you. Like, you know what I'm saying? So, but yeah, but that was memorable. I'll never forget that.
Yeah, no, definitely one of the greatest games. So please recap your list for the people so they can know what games they should go on YouTube and rewatch.
Okay, so again, I would say go watch. And this is one of those games that you probably don't remember, even think about. I would say go watch the Seahawks Steelers in 2015. It was a great game, especially when you'll see that Richard Sherman stopped your boy, A.B., Antonio Brown, follow him around the field, which is crazy. Then go to the 2000 Rams play the Bucks of Revenge game. That was a crazy Monday night game, a classic, all-time classic. Another all-time classic, 1994, Kansas City Chiefs versus the Denver Broncos. Montana going up against Elway for the last time, and it ended in a thriller. Last few seconds, Montana scored a touchdown. Then, of course, you got the Giants, San Francisco 2002 playoff game, and then the 2015 Seahawks versus the Green Bay Packers.
Okay, and that was the NFC Championship for number one.
Right.
So for my top five rewatchable games, number five was the 2012 AFC Divisional Playoff between the Ravens and Broncos. Great game. Number four, heartbreaker for the Saints, the Minnesota Miracle, 2017 NFC Divisional Round. Number three was the 2011 NFC Divisional Round, Alex Smith and the 49ers defeating the Saints. Number two, I had Super Bowl 49, Patriots Seahawks, you know, famously known for Marshawn Lynch not getting the ball at the goal line. Number one, Giants beat the undefeated Patriots 17-14 and Super Bowl 42. Man, I had a great time doing this with you, man. I got to get you on the podcast more often.
Oh, no doubt, man. This is always fun, man. Always, I was thinking something was wrong with me because I hadn't been in a while. I'm just messing with you. this is fun. I always have fun. I always do it, man. I appreciate it.
Oh, no problem at all, man. And please let people know where they can follow you and find your work.
Definitely on Facebook, Controversy Raphael, and always the 3-Point Conversion Facebook page, Twitter, Instagram, at 3-Point Conversion. Me personally, Controversy 21 on Twitter, and I'm sorry, Mr. Controversy 21 on Twitter and Instagram. So, and then we're on YouTube, the 3-Point Conversion YouTube channel. Have our own channel, a lot of great stuff, man, and definitely check us out on 3pointconversion.com where you can find some of Damian's work and everything else. And also, iHeart, we have a radio station or radio iHeart station on iHeart. So you go to iHeartRadio.com, you know, and then you go and look up the 3-Point Conversion and you will see all of our work. Damian's on this. You will find his podcast as well. Of course, myself and everyone else. So definitely come check us out, man. I appreciate this again.
Oh, no problem at all, man. Thank you for coming on. Remember to follow me at The Real Deal WDA on all platforms. Don't be selfish with the podcast. If you like it, share it with your friends. Tell your homeboys about it. All right. Don't be selfish with the macaroni. Spread it around. Make sure all your family members get it. Okay. And until next time, go real or go home.